and it's a pleasure to be here, and I thank the organizing committee, namely Professor Sedaka, for getting me down here. Now, the topic is sodium imbalance in patients who get admitted to the hospital. I think this is a wrong slide. So it's a problem that you commonly come across in the hospital setting. And I come from a hospital that has a very big geriatric footprint. And as you can see also, we have an abundance of water. You can see the lake, the man-made lake in front of our outpatient department. And also we have an underground waterfall as well. So it's not surprising that sodium problem is actually something we do see currently in Kuteh Puat, where I work. And these are our learning objectives. So let's start with a case. So this is a 78-year-old female who comes in disoriented in ED at about 10 p.m. She's taking Hyza Forte. So of note, she's hypotensive, ECG shows U-waves, and she has hyponatremia and hypokalemia. We don't have clickers, so I guess I'll have to answer the questions myself, but you can take some time to think through that. Option A is that we have about five options, so which of the one here would be the incorrect answer? Serum osmolality, urine sodium, urine osmolality can categorically differentiate the causes. She should be started on 2-liter normal saline with 20 millimoles KCl per half liter over 24 hours. Hyza Forte is an unlikely cause. She should be started on 3 cycles of KCl and 1 liter normal saline and 100 mils of 3% saline, or none of the above. So the option C is E, but in ED, the ED physician decides on taking option D, giving 3 cycles of KCl, half a liter of saline, and 100 mils of 3% saline to control the patient's symptoms. And these kind of cases actually should be admitted in HDU. 4 hours later, further labs come through. We find that the urine osmolality is high, the serum osmolality is low, urine sodium is high, and thyroid and cortisol functions are both normal. Repeat sodium shows an increase of 5 millimoles. Blood pressure and ECG has normalized. So as a clerking resident, you correctly ascribe the cause to Hyza Forte, which is a combination of losartan and hydrocortisone. But you're worried about dehydration, so you decide on giving a further 2 liters of normal saline over the next 24 hours. On the 8 a.m. round with your boss, you find that the patient is drooling and she cannot move all limbs. Blood pressure is normal. She has made about 600 mils of urine now. Her sodium is now about 122. So that's another 14 millimoles increment from the baseline. So what would you do? Which one here is the wrong option? You'll keep her kneel by mouth. You'll suggest you'll do an MRI of the brain. You'll look for causes of SIDH. You'll monitor her urine output hourly. You'll immediately stop the normal saline and give her desmopressin. So option C is obviously not the right option. So let's talk about hyponatremia. What is hyponatremia? So that's when you have a serum sodium of less than 135. But way back in 1968, Edelman realized that actually plasma sodium correlates very well with plasma osmolality. So if you are talking about plasma sodium concentration, you're actually talking about plasma osmolality. But the major determinant there is not sodium. It's actually the total body water. And so if you have hyponatremia, and as an extension you have hypoosmolality, most of the time it's actually due to an increment in your total body water. And total body water can go up for a lot of reasons. As you know, in women it's about 50%, in males about 60%. It can go up because you've taken extra water, especially hypotonic or any form of hypotonic fluids, or you are unable to achieve aquaresis. You cannot pass urine. And you will not be able to pass urine for two reasons, either because you have too much ADH secreted appropriately because of dehydration or volume contraction, or ADH is secreted inappropriately. It's rarely a sodium problem. So let's look at how the nephrons regulate sodium and water. So this is a cartoon of the nephron. We have here the proximal convoluted tubule, the distal, the thick ascending loop of Henle, the distal colon-to tubule together with the proximal collecting duct, which is a cell complex, and then we have the distal collecting duct. So sodium absorption takes place not because of differences or imbalances in the sodium concentration. Sodium absorption takes place because of volume contraction. So if you are hypotensive, your sympathetic activity will go up, you will produce more angiotensin II, so you will maximize sodium absorption at the proximal tubule. But that solution that you absorb is actually very isotonic to your plasma. And as you move further down the tubule, you go more distally, there will be further sodium absorption at the distal convoluted tubule, mainly through the thiazide-sensitive channel, the triamterene and amiloride epithelial sodium channel, and the aldosterone-sensitive sodium KATPase. So the fluid that finally gets into the collecting duct actually is a very diluted fluid. So what you have effectively is a form of desalination. But you need to get that fluid back into your plasma, otherwise that patient will be dehydrated. So that's where you need to have on your collecting duct certain channels called aquaporins, and it's mainly aquaporin II, that will get that water back. That water will never get back into your serum unless you can generate a certain high tonicity in your medullary interstitial capillary bed. And this is achieved by this pump here called the sodium 2 chloride K channel, which is the furosemide sensitive channel. If you don't generate that hypertonicity, water cannot cross from the collecting duct lumen into the vascular bed. How do you generate the aquaporins? And that's what ADH does. And ADH usually can be stimulated by a number of factors, whether hemodynamic or osmotic. And certain non-osmotic factors can generate it, pain, nausea, drugs, and so forth. So in so doing, if you have ADH, you will then produce a urine which is very concentrated. It can go as high as 1,200 milliomole per kg of osmolarity. Or if you don't have ADH, then you will produce a very diluted urine. So in effect, your urine osmolality can actually be a good biomarker for ADH activity. But why do we worry about hyponatremia? When your plasma osmolality is very low, you have excess water, that water needs to move into the cell. Okay? If it goes into your muscle, it's not a problem. But going into your brain, which is confined in a very tight space in your cavarium, that can lead to cerebral edema, uncoiled herniation, and even death. In the more long term, and this is something which is coming more vogue now, especially in elderly, there are issues also with cognitive impairment, gait disturbances, osteoporosis, and fractures. Now, if you don't have aquaporins at your blood-brain barrier, the excess water in your intravascular compartment cannot move into the brain. In fact, it's been shown in rats who have knockout aquaporins, if you reduce their serum osmolality, they don't get cerebral edema. There are certain patients who are more at risk, especially pregnant ladies, but perimenstrual ladies who have very high progesterone, which makes their astrocytes more permeable. They generate more aquaporins and therefore more at risk for cerebral edema. But the brain cannot sustain cerebral edema, like I said before, otherwise it undergoes an uncoiled herniation. So it must get rid of this excess water. And how it does so within about 48 hours. And that's why there's this cutoff of 40 hours for between acute and chronic hyponatremia. So it will eject certain osmolite, starting with sodium, potassium, and ultimately things like taurine, glutamine, phosphocreatinine, and myoacetol. In our patient, she's in a state of equilibrium whereby you have a bit of acute and chronic hyponatremia. At times she's asymptomatic, at times she's asymptomatic. Now, if you were to actually put 1 liter of normal saline, and as you know, normal saline is isotonic to your serum, but if actually you look at the concentration, it's actually 154 millimoles. But why so? That's because it's the way sodium distributes into your plasma. Your plasma has a virtual compartmentalization of non-aqueous and an aqueous phase. The aqueous phase is about 97%, non-aqueous phase is about 7%. So if you look about 97%, 93% of your 154, that's about 140 moles. That concept is very important because most sodium analyte actually factor that 93% when they do it. whether it's indirect photogenometry or whether it's flame photometry. That concept is important to garner so that you can understand how pseudohyponatremia happens. So in pseudohyponatremia, essentially what you have is you have a reduction in your aqueous phase. Let's say if it goes down to 80%, you will have 154 times 80%, that's about 120. But the sodium measured is actually that level, but your actual sodium is normal. There are a number of causes of things that can reduce your aqueous phase. If you have myeloma, if you have triglyceridemia, you have high-dose IVIG, all these can lead to a so-called pseudohyponatremia. But essentially, the plasma osmolality is normal. There's no excess water. Your total body water is the same. There's no water shift. And this is what the most textbook will call an isosmolar hyponatremia. There's another form of hyponatremia called translocational hypotremia, whereby you have a very osmotic agent in your ECF. And that agent, if it doesn't cross the biomembrane because of its high osmolality, it can actually pull water out of your intracellular fluid compartment. And that water will then dilute your sodium. A number of agents can do that, namely glucose, glycine, sorbitol, mannitol, and others. In fact, you can tell how much your hyperglycemia is contributing towards your hyponatremia by using the CATS correction. Urea doesn't do that because urea can crisscross the biomembrane very effectively. So it's not effective or small. It has high osmolarity but no tonicity. So it does not change sodium concentration. In most of these instances of translocational hyponatremia, the serum osmolarity is high. And this is what the textbook will call a hyperosmolar hyponatremia. Cerebral edema does not take place unless if you metabolize the substrate or you push that substrate into the cell. For instance, if somebody with DKA, you're giving IV insulin, you push the glucose into the cell, the water will then follow and lead to cerebral edema. So what can you use as a diagnostic approach to hyponatremia? Well, there are some cases which are obviously, you can tell obviously clinically. For instance, patients with congestive heart failure, chronic liver disease, or hypothyroidism. This would be called a hypovolemic hyponatremia. Or you can tell when somebody has Addison's disease. If the patient has very frank volume contraction also, you can tell by looking at all the telltale signs. And this would be called a hypovolemic hyponatremia. But there are certain instances where hyponatremia can be very challenging clinically, especially patients who have subtle volume contractions, patients who take small amount of solutes and small amount of fluids, the so-called tea and toast syndrome, elderly on thiazides, syndrome of inappropriate ADH secretion, which textbook will call a euvolemic hyponatremia, or in the neurosurgical ward, patients with cerebral salt wasting, pregnant ladies with recessed osmostat, or patients who've taken an inordinate amount of water, they've increased their total body water. Commonly seen in marathon runners, because if you're running for 42K and you're getting half a liter of fluids every 5K, you're more likely to increase your total body water. Perioperative patients who are kneeled by mouth, they are stimulating ADH because they are in pain, they are getting anesthetic drugs, and they are on a very hypotonic phase, also are prone to hyponatremia. Sometimes the causes can be very multifactorial. I'm going to leave out the salt losing nephropathy because to the nephrologist, this entirety does not exist. Now, can urine osmolality and urine sodium help you in your diagnosis? Now, let's look at those four broad categories which, like I showed you earlier, are a little bit less difficult to detect clinically. The only entirety whereby those two indices help would be actually patients who are taking excess water, because in that instance, your urine osmolality and your urine sodium will be very low. It does not help much with SIDH, although a number of authorities will say your sodium and your osmolality in the urine will be very high, as there's quite a huge overlap with dehydration itself. Now, a little bit on SIDH, you need to exclude a lot of things. But importantly, what you find is that the uric acid and the urea are very low because you have a very high fractional excretion of those two elements. Okay? There's a variable ADH level, so you should not be using ADH level or any other surrogate assays like copeptin to detect the level. The treatment currently, a standard treatment would be tolvaptan, but you look at the cost, $438 per tablet, beyond the reach of most patients in resource-challenged settings. It has some issues as well, can affect the liver, can lead to acaresis, can lead to overcorrection, and can also interact with certain drugs. Oral urea has come back recently on a paper in States. Water restriction, not so effective, can only push up your sodium by about 1 to 2 millimoles per day. Now, the problem with SIEH is it's overdiagnosed. It overlaps a lot with thiazide-induced hyponatremia. So if you're going to rely on your increased urine sodium, on your increased urine osmolality, or your ratio of your urine sodium and potassium to your serum sodium of less than one, you're going to be misdiagnosing quite a bit. To me, the best approach is you give the patient fluid. If the sodium goes down, then you know that is SRDH. Now, our patient had actually osmotic demyelination syndrome. Why did this happen, and what is osmotic demyelination syndrome? So this is due to a rapid overcorrection of hyponatremia. You subject the astrocytes to hypertonic stress. They are damaged, the blood-brain barrier gets damaged, you get desiccations of your neuronal elements in your both your pons and also in your extrapontine area. And this is clearly shown here by this sagittal T1 showing a pontine ODS here, and here showing the, on T2, you have hyperintense lesion in the basal ganglia, in extrapontine site. Okay. But for you to understand ODS, you need to also understand your fluids. Know which of your fluids are isotonic, and know which one of your fluids are hypotonic, and which ones are hypotonic. So why was sodium overcorrected after 10 hours of treatment? So let's go back and have a look. 100 mils of 3% saline, 1.5 liters of normal saline. That's about 280 millimoles of sodium front-loaded in ED and HDU. So for somebody about 60 kg, you've actually pushed up the sodium by about 9 millimoles. You expect to push it up by about 9 millimoles. But what we actually saw was a 14 millimoles increment. So where did these extra 5 millimoles came from? So the reason is that if you're going to correct hypokalemia, you're going to correct potassium, actually you're giving sodium. So every molar equivalent of potassium you give, you're actually pushing one sodium into your ECV. Okay, so you have to be cognizant of that. If you are correcting the hypotension, you're also pushing up the sodium. Why? Because when you are hypotensive, your extracellular volume is actually contracted. ADH is at its peak. You have reduced acquiresis. But once you correct the volume, all the volumetric receptors are now toned down. ADH secretion is reduced, and you are now going to have overt acquiresis. Your total body water will go down, and you'll have a rebound increase in sodium. So it's important to closely monitor the urine output. In fact, it can be argued that for every 3 mils per kg per hour of acquiresis, your sodium increase goes up by about 1 millimole per hour. So what should have been the correct management of this patient? Treat the thing that will kill the patient first. Address the potassium. Give 3 cycles. Give 2 cycles of potassium over 2 to 3 hours. Treat the hypotension with a fluid which is isotonic to that patient's current sodium of 108. Okay, we'll come to that in a minute. Because if you do this, you will correct the blood pressure, you will switch off the ADH without effectively giving more sodium to the patient. Recheck the sodium again. If you feel the patient is still symptomatic, or the delta sodium has gone up by less than 4 millimoles, maybe give 100 mils of 3% saline. We'll come back to 3% saline in a little while. Repeat the sodium again. And remember this, it's about repeating. It's not about using formula. It's about checking, reevaluating the patient all the time. Watch your urine output. This patient should be in a HDU setting. They should be having a urinary catheter as well. In fact, you should be sometimes checking the sodium 2 to 3, 4 times a day. Okay? And be prepared to use desmopressin if you think you've overshot. Okay? So this table actually is from Dr. Stern, who's in Canada. So it's from his website, his blog. So this is how it works. So how you choose a fluid which is isotonic to your serum. So let's say if your sodium is 117 and you want to give potassium and you don't want to add additional sodium to that patient. So the fluid you will give as a resuscitating fluid actually will be half saline. So if the sodium is 108 and you want to give 20 millimoles of potassium as part of the rehydrating fluid. So the fluid you should be giving should be a combination of 20% normal saline and 80% half saline. So when can we use 3% saline? Obviously, when the patient is acutely symptomatic, let's say a marathon runner who's taken about 5 liters of water over 2 hours of running, or any form of symptomatic hyponatremia. More so in patients with SIDH because you don't want to give a lot of volume, you just want to give more sodium at the expense of less volume. So what it does, it increases your sodium, by 1 mL/kg will increase your sodium by about 1 mmol. There are different ways of giving it. You can give it as an infusion or you can give it as a bolus. You don't need a central line for it. So how do we deal with the specter of osmotic demyelination syndrome? Know the patients who are at risk. And our patient actually had 3 risk factors. She was hypokalemic, she was elderly, had taken thiazide, and sodium was actually quite low. You can also argue that she was probably malnourished. So for the high-risk patients, try and get that sodium up by only 6 millimoles in 24 hours. And be prepared to use a prophylactic desmopressin. If you think the patient is low risk, you can allow a larger margin of increment. And if you feel you've overcorrected, the patient is well, no symptoms, try and bring it down. The traditional way of doing this is actually to give 5% dextrose, but there's no harm in giving desmopressin as well. So we move on to talk a little bit, I think we still got a bit of time, we can talk a little bit about hypernatremia. So this is another case. You are asked to see an 88-year-old bedbound female on NG feeding with history of hypertension. She's confused, you find that she's dehydrated, she's hypotensive, and the sodium is 160. The K is normal, and the urea creatinine ratio also is a bit high. High serum osmolality, the urine sodium is 15, urine K 80, and urine osmolality is very high. Her urine bag, last drained 24 hours ago, has about 400 mL of urine, and city brain is unremarkable. So what is the least likely cause of her problem? So it's unlikely going to be diabetes insipidus here. Why? A high urine osmolality and a urine osmolality greater than plasma osmolality exclude diabetes insipidus. What it suggests is actually there's a lot of ADH at work there. In diabetes insipidus, ADH is not or inadequately acting. So your urine osmolality would actually be lower than your plasma osmolality. So essentially, hypernatremia is the counter to hyponatremia. The sodium is more than 150. So it's more of a water deficit than a sodium excess. You will not find it in normal people walking around who are deep sick or able to drink because thirst is the best defense against hypernatremia. Okay? The moment your plasma osmolality goes more than 285, ADH will kick in so that then you can conserve more water. And that will also stimulate the thirst receptors. Absence of or inability to appreciate thirst, aphasic patients, stroke patients, or inability to say, look, I'm thirsty on itself, may lead to hypernatremia. And this picture here is a very interesting because what they did was they used rats actually in whom you can actually stimulate the thirst and the osmoreceptors by using certain laser stimulators. So you can actually induce a form of neurogenic DI depending on how you stimulate it. And you will find that actually those rats who in whom you are induced hypernatremia actually do run for the water if their thirst receptor is actually intact. So hypernatremia, more problem of loss of water. So how this happens, you can lose water from the gut, from the urine, or from the skin, or you may have inadequate ADH. Or in some rare cases, in pregnant women, they may produce this hormone called vasopressinase from the placenta, which will break down ADH. This would be called a hypovolemic or euvolemic hypernatremia. Alternatively, you can have excess salt intake, either hydrologically or deliberately. Sodium bicarb is used as an alkalinizing agent in a number of instances, 3% saline as an irrigant. Citrate dialysis in the ICU, senior drowning, and there are patients also who've come in because they've taken a lot of salt to chase away the spirits as well. This will be called a hypervolemic hypernatremia. We are running out of time, So a good history is important. If the urine is very dilute, okay, ask about drugs, look for causes of hypokalemia, hypercalcemia. And if there's a brain injury, you want to think about neurogenic DI as well. Is there a role for water deprivation? I think if you are the resident on the service, you're asked to this, I think it's just your bad day, because this is something that very barbaric. But I'll tell you, there's another option. You don't need to wait for the sodium to normalize. If the sodium is high, just give the patient desmopressin and check the urine osmolality before and after. So if you give desmopressin, you find that the post-desmopressin urine osmolality has gone up, so you're probably dealing with a central DI. Okay. Be cautious, just like in hyponatremia, hypernatremia, there's a brain adaptation, but it's the opposite. You actually get a cerebral desiccation. And if you correct it after the brain has adapted, you can actually get cerebral, and you overshoot, you can actually get cerebral edema. So the principles of management, I think we, So I think I will probably skip the management part, but important is you need to work out the total the water deficit, and also to look at insensible salt water loss as well, so that you can come up with the actual volume for you to replace. And this volume can actually be replaced mainly orally via NG tube, free water, with some half saline or even 5% dextrose. So in summary, dysnatremia is a very challenging issue. You need to understand the physiology. You need to understand how EDH works. It's not so much of a sodium problem, but a water problem. I thank you for your attention.